Okay, hai, assalamualaikum. So kita jumpa lagi untuk kelas hari ni dalam minggu ke 11. Kita sekarang ni kita kat minggu ke 11. Kita akan masuk chapter 5, right? So sebelum raya kita cuti raya panjang kan? So sebelum raya kita dah habis chapter 4, right? So sekarang ni kita akan masuk chapter 5. So chapter 5, interfacing and communication. Right, so lesson outcome dia, kita akan tengok peripheral, I.O. consideration, program I.O., interrupt driven I.O. and then direct memory access. But untuk hari ni kita akan tengok interrupt, sampai interrupt je, yang the rest kita akan continue untuk next class. Right, so first thing first, kita akan tengok peripheral. So peripheral device that are separate from the basic computer, not the CPU, memory or power supply, classified as input output and storage, connected via port which is parallel or USB or serial. So interface to system bus, kita akan ada dekat dalam tu adalah SSI IDE dengan PCM CIA. Okay. And then kita tengok I/O consideration, speed issue. So speed issue yang ada dekat I/O adalah CPU operates at same speed, CPU operate at speed much faster than the fastest I/O. So CPU operates lagi laju berbanding dengan I/O. Alright, so device operate at different speed. So since benda tu dia operates dekat different speed, kadang-kadang kita ada burst of data. So bila ada burst of data, dia akan transfer data dalam blok tau. Dalam blok dia bahagikan, contoh data tu besar, dia bahagikan part-part dan dia hantar parcel by parcel lah, macam tu. Right, nanti dekat dalam CPU dia akan combine balik. So itu cara untuk dia ada speed issue kat situ. Alright, so coordination, several device perform I/O simultaneously, unexpected input. So various input formats and then ada status information needed for each device. So ini adalah coordination. So isu-isu yang ada berkenaan dengan I/O dan CPU. Alright, so I/O architecture, there are various ways to interconnect the CPU, memory and I/O peripheral, each with their own advantages and disadvantages. So setiapnya dia ada beberapa cara untuk connect dan ada kebaikan dan ada keburukan untuk setiap dia. So kat bawah ni ada contoh dia, program I/O and DMA. So kat sini kita ada CPU, ada memory, ada I/O module dengan I/O device. So I/O module dan I/O device dia boleh interact to each other. So dari I/O module ni dia boleh connect dengan memory. So sama ada boleh CPU boleh direct connect dengan I/O ataupun CPU connect dengan memory dan memory connect dengan I/O. So dua-dua tu boleh. Okay, buffering. So buffering, what is buffering? Buffering is holding and release part of data at particular time. Maksudnya buffer ni dia pegang data tu dan melepaskan data tu pada masa-masa yang diperlukan. Okay, handshaking. Handshaking adalah a process that take place when a computer is about to communicate with a foreign device to establish rules for communication. So contohnya komputer nak connect, nak interact dengan device tu, dia handshaking ni macam dia bagi tahu orang tu, saya nak connect dengan awak, macam tu dia bagi salam lah, macam tu lah. Alright, so and then kita tengok I/O architecture untuk program I/O dan interrupt driven I/O, and then the direct memory access controller. So program I/O kita adalah CPU control. And then interrupt driven I/O adalah external input control. Direct memory access controllers adalah method for transferring data between main memory and a device that bypass the CPU. Right. And then program I/O and output. Okay, it's a method of transferring data between the CPU and the peripheral such as a network adapter or an data storage device. Happens when software running on the CPU use instruction that access I/O address space to perform data transfer to or from an I/O device. Alright, And then kita tengok ini simplest method for performing I/O where an I/O module is connected to a pair of I/O registered in the CPU via bus. Okay, yang connectkan dia adalah bus. Alright, so function dia recognize message from device address to it and accept command from the CPU. Provide a buffer when the data or from memory can be held until it can be transferred to the disk. Provide the necessary registers and control to perform a direct memory transfer. Physically control the device and then copies data from its buffer to the device from the CPU to its buffer. Notify with interrupts. Okay, tu dia punya functions I/O. Alright, and then kita tengok interrupt pula. Okay, interrupt signal the cause this signal that cause the CPU to alter its normal flow on instruction execution. So contoh interrupt ni dia ada CPU kan ada execution kan, tapi bila the interrupt instruction je, CPU tu akan hold dan dia buat dulu interrupt tu, dah settle interrupt tu, baru dia continue dengan dia punya original tasking. Right, so dia kat sini free CPU from waiting for event, and then provide control for external input, and then example unexpected input, abnormal situation, illegal instruction, or multitasking, or multiprocessing. Okay, simple example untuk interrupt adalah bila kita dah buat execution, kan kita nak display dekat screen ke atau kita nak minta user input kan? Kan awak punya proses program awak tu akan hold kan, so kat situ adalah interrupt. User akan masukkan apa-apa dan dia baru dimasukkan, baru dia continue dengan dia punya task dia. Ha, itulah example interrupt yang paling senang kita nak faham apa tu interrupt. And interrupt is a call from a CPU to interact or service that interrupt unit. Interrupt cause the temporary suspend of the program in the progress. Okay, interrupt all the information about the programs being suspended, including the last location of the last instruction execute. The value of data in various register is saved in a known part of memory, either the process control block or the stack area. Computer that branch to a special interrupt handler program elsewhere in memory, the process where the interrupt handler programs determine the appropriate course of action is known as servicing the interrupt. Alright, ini adalah cerita pasal interrupt lah. Okay, interrupt. Okay, ini adalah normal execution kan, and then ada happens interrupt kat sini. So bila dia ada interrupt kat sini, dia halt normal execution ni, then dia finish current instruction lah. Right, and then the suspend operation tu. Okay, bila ada normal instruction, dia finish yang instruction last tu, lepas tu dia suspend operation dan store registers. Contents of registers store in stack, dia akan simpan. Okay, jump to interrupt routine and execute. So dia akan terus pergi dekat interrupt routine dan execute interrupt routine. Dah settle interrupt routine, baru dia return to normal operation dan restore MP status. Dia akan ambil balik register dia save dekat sini dan dia continue dengan execution asal dan dia buat lah continue normal execution. Macam tu lah interrupt. Okay, and then uses of interrupt: external event notifier, kalau ada notifier, free CPU from pulling, a means for the user to control the computer from an input device. Okay, so completion signals mean a control for the flow of data to an external device. Allocation of CPU time, kalau dia ada time sharing. Okay, abnormal event indicator, power failure apa ke. Software interrupt: software simulation of interrupt, address space indicates which interrupt is called. Okay, and then kita tengok multiple interrupt will occur from time to time. Are the interrupts already awaiting service, and if so, how does the computer determine the order in which the interrupt gets service? How does the computer identify the interrupt device? Okay, dia ada dua cara, two different processing method for determining which device initiate the interrupt. Okay, so the first one is vector interrupt, the second one is pole interrupt. Okay, so vector interrupt, the address of interrupting device is included as part of the interrupt. Okay, interrupt ni cepat but requires additional hardware untuk implement. So, bila dia ada interrupt key, dia terus pergi dekat address, interrupt key dan jump kepada routine. Dia tak ada buat pooling, tak ada check satu-satu. Dia terus dia pergi dekat situ. Alright. So, kalau untuk pool interrupt, check, dia akan check satu-satu device mana yang buat interrupt tu. Then, provide general interrupt that is shared by all devices. Okay. And then computer identify which interrupting device by pulling each device. Itu yang dia check satu-satu. And then baru dia jump dekat key service routine. Okay, yang ni lambat sikit lah sebab dia check satu-satu. Kalau yang tadi tu dia ada setiap satu device tu dia ada satu interrupt vector tu. Okay, kita tengok how does pooling operates. In pooling, CPU will ask each device in sequence whether it is ready for communication. If device is ready, the data transfer takes place between device and CPU. If the device is not ready or it is complete the data transfer, then CPU akan check untuk next device dalam chain dalam urutan tu. So main disadvantages adalah CPU remain busy most of the time with the pooling. So some useful tasks get less time to execute. So to execute task dia ambil masa lebih panjang lah sebab masa tu jadi pindik. Okay, this method is useful only if CPU has contain less IO device. Okay, ini adalah vector versus pole. Apa beza dia? Okay, vector dia reduce service latency, no instruction execute to pull many device. Okay, dia boleh pull many device tau. Dia boleh check banyak-banyak device ha, macam tu lah. So, let requesting device identify itself directly with special signal. Dia CPU used to find vector interrupt address in vector table. So, table lookup is done by hardware. So, kerja ini ada satu hardware yang tolong CPU tu untuk ambil instead of dia check sesuatu, dia boleh terus identify device mana yang buat interrupt tu. Okay, vector table located at fixed address but interrupt routine can be anywhere in memory, require priority interrupt manager, accept all interrupt request to determine the highest priority request. Faster identification of highest priority interrupt request is identified by hardware. High cost since each interrupt source has its own vector interrupt to access directly to its own routine. Okay, so kalau pool, priority is established by the order of pooling device. So, dia akan check satu-satu, flexible since it is established by software. Dia lebih flexible sebab dia tak perlukan hardware lah. Low cost tapi dia sangat slow lah sebab CPU tu diganggu dengan buat pooling tu. Okay, example of multiple interrupt. So example dia contoh kat sini, ini adalah masa kan, one quantum. Right, so program one execute and then ada clock interrupt. So program one ni suspended, dia akan pergi dekat operating system di special program, dia akan select next program. So bila dia select next program, dia akan resume executing program 2 ni. Okay, and then clock interrupt, program 2 ni suspended dan dia akan pergi dekat select next program. So dia akan check kalau ada program lain yang ada interrupt. Okay, So kat sini program 1 dan program 2 suspended. And then kalau ada next program ni, program 3 dia buat, contoh eh, dia buat, dia siap, and then dia akan check mana yang suspended tadi, dia akan continue lah. Okay, so multiple interrupt and prioritization. Multiple interrupt can be handled by assigning priority to each interrupt. A higher priority interrupt can be interrupt other interrupt of lower priority, but a lower priority interrupt will have to wait until the higher priority interrupt is complete. So interrupt ni dia ada high priority or low priority. So kalau high priority interrupt, dia boleh kacau, dia boleh hold low priority. So tapi lower tak boleh hold high priority interrupt. Okay, priority I said is established by in a logical way. So highest priority are reserved for time sensitive situations such as power failure or external event that are being time measured. Task completion in interrupt usually take lower priority. Okay, so highest priority selalunya untuk macam power failure, macam kalau ada apa-apa notification yang keluar kan, yang dia ada masa, so dia akan itu high priority. Kalau macam yang complete task ni, kira dia low priority lah. Okay, so category of interrupt, so dia ada maskable dengan non-maskable. So maskable, the interrupt will not be accepted, can be selective or disable. Non-maskable, the interrupt will always be acknowledged and accept, such as power failure. Okay, itu sahaja. Nanti kita sambung lagi, kita jumpa lagi untuk next class. Bye. Thank you.